because I have a guest spinner today. So she is going to take over the entire spin, from the spin through the education. Here she comes.
Hi, everybody. I am Alice's friend. My name is Sharon Muja, and I am a birth doula and childbirth educator and a writer, and I do the Lamaze Connecting the Dots blog, and I train doulas, and I train childbirth educators, and do a million other things. But I'm delighted that Alice asked me to be the spinner today. So let's see what the wheel is going to tell us. I feel like a little like Vanna White. Is that?
I'm going to help hold your wheel.
Okay. All right. Here we go. I don't know what I'm going to be talking about. Oh, the pelvis. Oh, do I take that off?
No, you can leave.
All right, the pelvis. Well, this is great because I happen to have some props right here, and this is a pelvis. Pelvis is pretty cool. One of the things that happens during pregnancy is that there's a hormone called relaxin that the pregnant person produces, and what that hormone does is it makes everything, I like to say, loosey-goosey, where all the joints are flexible and movable and can open and close and stretch exactly the way they need to let a baby through. Some of the things that I want you to know about the pelvis, and I'm actually going to ask Alice to get me another prop.
Oh yeah.
Which is the Dutch pelvis, which is in the big cabinet underneath the TV.
Okay.
And you'll see it on the left. So what I want to show you is that the pelvis, this is called the pelvic inlet. The pelvic inlet is widest from side to side, but the pelvic outlet, which is it's wooden block. It's right there to your right.
Okay. Oh.
Yes, right there. And then the pelvic outlet, which is this part here, is widest from front to back. And excuse me, but I am missing my tailbone, which I, little triangular bone that I lost just a while ago. And so what the baby has to do is the baby has to navigate through the pelvis facing one side or the other, and ideally it would be something like this. The baby has to face this way, and then as it descends, it rotates toward the back. Because if you look at a fetus, the baby is also widest from front to back. And one of the things that this baby does is it tucks its chin to its chest. Do you see how that changes the diameter? Tucks its chin to its chest so that it can fit better through the pelvis. The baby enters the pelvis and rotates, ideally toward the back, and continues to descend. And now the baby can fit in shoulders wide. And then as the baby keeps going, under the pubic bone, it flexes its head back, and its head is born, and it restitutes, and it keeps going. Really what I want to talk more about is the pelvis. So now that you know about this, I want to show you a couple of landmarks. There are these ischial spines, not important what they're called, but what I want you to know is that these ischial spines right here, they are the narrowest part of the pelvis. And they also dissect the pelvis, or bisect the pelvis, in the midline. That is considered the absolute midline of the pelvis. So when the baby is above those lines or those spines, bottom of the baby's head or whatever the presenting part is, we say the baby is floating. And when the baby meets those spines, we say the baby is engaged. So that's one way that your healthcare provider can tell you how high or low the baby is. If you're having your first baby, it's not uncommon for your baby to take a while to get down there. And then if you're having your second or more baby, they tend to find their way a lot quicker. Also something I want to show you is that this is the sacrum right here, and you can see that it moves. And this is often called the gate of birth. And as the baby is coming down, they are pushing that sacrum out of the way, and that is creating space. Do you see how much more space that makes? Now, if I were laying on my back, which unfortunately, at least in the United States, is a really common position for people to give birth, that sacrum has no ability to move. So what I encourage you to think about is, how can you make space for that baby? What can you do to get the sacrum out of the way? Even something as simple as just rotating a little bit to the side. Do you see how it can move now? Or of course, getting upright or forward leaning also helps a lot. So we have this gate of birth, which is has the ability to move, and we have this overall pelvis. I want to show you a little bit. This is an amazing tool, and this was made by a dear friend of mine's husband, Heather Crossan, from Calgary, Alberta, in Canada, and it's called a Dutch pelvis. It's a great teaching tool. What I have here is I have a little baby. And this is the baby's head, and this is the baby's shoulders. And the baby enters the pelvis facing to the side, just like we talked about with that pelvis there, and then turns internally to face the back. Can you see? Turns internally to face the back. Now the shoulders fit. And as the baby descends and the head is born, the baby restitutes to navigate the bottom part of the pelvis, and the shoulders come out. That is a really cool, easily made, probably not as nice as this one that they gave me, but easily made teaching tool that helps your families or you, if you are expecting a baby, to understand exactly what the baby navigates. Let's see, what else do I want to tell you about the pelvis in the last minute or two is that sometimes this little part here, which is called the pubic symphysis, is a joint that has a little piece of cartilage in the middle. And sometimes toward the end of pregnancy, it can aggravate the pregnant person. It gets a little bit separated, can cause some pain. I could go on and on and on, but what I want to tell you is that this is an amazing structure that has the ability to move and help the baby to navigate and find their way through the pelvis as you get ready to meet your baby. So thanks, Alice, for letting me wane on, wax on.
Thanks, hey, Alice.
enjoy the rest of the spins for the month of December.